Welcome to a new episode of The Brand Called You. Today, not only do I have a very, very successful professional turned entrepreneur, but also he has been someone I have known for almost 60 years from the time we were children, Neeraj Kanwar. Neeraj, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Ashutosh.
Neeraj and I were together in Hansraj College. Then he went up to IIM Bangalore. He worked for Asian Paints, then the UB Group. And then he has become an entrepreneur in the energy sector. Neeraj, you moved from the corporate world to become an entrepreneur. But before we talk about your entrepreneurial journey, talk to us about your corporate life.
First of all, thank you, Ashutosh, for having me here. I'm delighted to reconnect after almost 50 years now. My father was in the services. And my initial days, which is about 50 years back, was a typical service life.
Correct.
And to begin with, in those days, you had only two professions open to you. Either you take up engineering or you take up medicine.
Correct.
And so I was, told in that in the family you have engineers. And so I therefore decided to take up medicine. And even in those days, after doing your medicine or whatever, the openings were largely in the government sector. So we joined the medicine stream, but that's where I had my first setback very early on. I couldn't clear the entrance, and so being an above average student, a sportsman, and an all round kind of involvement in games and extracurricular, I was quite surprised as to why it has come.
I remember medicines, you and I had similar stories.
So, and that's where my dad came about, and he told me this is not the end of the road and it's only a bend on the road. And then I decided to continue with my graduation. And after doing graduation, I realized that I had specialized in a field, a zoology honors. Now, I couldn't really figure out what could life be as a zoologist, especially in India 50 years back. And then I decided that I need to course correct. And I wanted to do this, an MBA, because those time it was just starting out. And but I realized that, why should an MBA program select me, especially with the background I have. But I got over my initial disappointments and I worked hard and I could make the grade. And when I joined the institute, I remember one of the professors telling us that you are from the first batch of CAT.
Mm-hmm.
And there I was at IIM Bangalore with, I think, brilliant minds. 90% of the people were from all engineers or from IITs.
Correct.
So it was not easy going. I had to do a lot of catching up because a lot of subjects, and especially the quantitative subjects, I had lost track of in class 10th or 11th. So I had a lot of catching up to do, but it was a challenging and enjoyable journey. And after doing my graduation, I got picked up from campus by Asian Paints.
Correct.
And Asian Paints, I spent about 10 years. I really loved that company because the setup was very entrepreneurial in nature.
What were some of your key challenges and learnings in Asian Paints?
Asian Paints. Now, Asian Paints, the first advantage is it's a very hands-on and professionally driven company. So very early on, you're given a lot of responsibilities. So I remember straight out of college, I was made in charge of a state.
Mm.
And they just virtually at the end of the, beginning of the year, they would tell you this is your budget and this is your target and you are left to do on your own. So you can, appoint dealers, you can recruit people. So it's very much like an entrepreneur.
Mm.
And the major challenges was that even in spite of Asian Paints being the number one company, there were markets which they had very low market share, So I was put into one of those markets in Northeast. And it was a great learning to, you know, be selling a company's product, which was, you know, leading paint company elsewhere. Mm-hmm. Nobody had heard of
that.
And then I moved on to large market share area in the West. Mm-hmm. And there the challenge was that how do you grow the market, which you already having 80% yeah. market share.
Yeah.
So these were two typically the nice. Challenges, and the learning was phenomenal. Mm-hmm. In fact, I had a clear hand to change distribution networks, and the company were very supportive of failures. Mm-hmm. So that gave me a lot of confidence, because once you, that is out of your mind, so you just go ahead and do what you want. Okay.
And so then you moved to UB.
Then I had worked for about 10 years. So now I decided that my experience was very specialized in consumer durables. And then you have the consumer, fast-moving consumer company like yeah. Levers and or soft drinks. So, not so much liquor, but yes, liquor too. So then I decided to move to FMCG, and I was recruited by UB Group in the soft drinks.
Yeah.
And those days, soft drink was a very talked about subject, because Pepsi and Coke both were entering into India. But the moment they decided to enter into India, our company chairman decided to close shutters for the soft drinks unit, because, you know, he was his specialization, you know, was in the alcoholic beverages segment. So then I default came into the alcoholic beverages segment, and there the challenges were, it's a highly regulated market. So virtually every state has its own rules, and every state has a different market setup. So you have markets which are totally controlled by the government in terms at the wholesale level, at the retail level, and then you have markets which are, you know, controlled by the government at the wholesale level, but the retail is total market oriented.
Right.
So that you know, selling in those kind of conditions was a huge challenge and a huge learning. And sometime during that time, I have been, you know, very fond of outdoor life. Mm-hmm. Trekking and mountains have fascinated me right from childhood. Mm-hmm. So, and just to go off the point, we have a small orchard very close to where my work is. Mm-hmm. And my family and me used to take time out. Once a year we used to visit there. It involved, there were no roads, so it involved a long trek up to the orchard. Mm-hmm. It's at the top of the mountain at 7,000 feet. So you are surrounded by fruits all over. Mm-hmm. And I used to wonder that, can I live a life, a quality of life like this, mm-hmm. and yet have good quality work to do? Mm-hmm. And but that mind, you know, it kept going on in my mind, and I was just wondering, how can I make this possible? Then all of a sudden, while I had just shifted from UB to Diageo, there was a small ad which came in the paper that the government of Himachal is privatizing small hydropower sector.
Okay.
So that is what set me thinking, because very near my place there were a lot of streams. And then I said, everything fell into place. I said, this is the place. And this is the thing I would like to do all my life. Mm. And that's where the story, my corporate
your
life
entrepreneurial
ended.
Start.
Yeah, wonderful. Corporate life ended. And the good, the fortunate part was that initially, setting up hydro units, you require to take a lot of clearances. Mm. And there is sufficient time available to you to, I would say, pursue your professional career and give some time to, you know, push letters or to do some, you know, work on the side. So for a brief period of a year or two, I went along with both, parallelly both professions. Till such time, I got the power purchase agreement signed up with the government. And that's when I decided that my corporate life should end and I should begin a new life.
That's a very sensible thing you're mentioning. You know, I'm sure a lot of our viewers, we listen to you about this, that you carried on with your professional life without giving it up
till
you were sure of your entrepreneurial
career. Absolutely. And it was part of no plan. It just happened to be such. Mm. And in fact, I must share a story with you here that it is not easy because I remember I found a good mentor in my dad. Mm. And so he had the engineering skills. So, and he was in his heart also an entrepreneur. Mm. He worked in the government, he was with the United Nations. So he was also wanting to do something similar to what I had in mind. And then he says, why not we do it together? Mm. So we decided to apply. And when we applied, I realized that I didn't have 3 years balance sheet with me. I didn't have the kind of, you know, network to show to the government that, you know, here I am, and to convince them that, you know, I can put up a project. So I remember we went to the committee and they looked at all my papers and they said that, again, you know, the same question, the zoologist and MBA, and you're selling liquor, and now why do you want to come here? So I said, look, we are power deficient, and the village I am in, I said, power will definitely help in the social and economic development of that place. So he says, no, that's all right, but then you have no technical expertise. Mm-hmm. So I said, I have a mentor with me, so that part they were convinced about. But then they were saying, like, you know, we want something more. So I just, something just struck me, and I said, yes, I'll, once I have a small power unit, I'll set up a small golf course next to it, because you require huge area, and I can promote night golf, so promote tourism. So that evoked a lot of amusement all around. But they were polite enough to tell me that, look, we are going to allot only to those people who have a net worth of at least 3 crores. I had no kind of that kind of a network. So I, you know, we walked out and thinking, but, you know, I felt that still there was something in me which kept telling me that something is going to come out here. So anyway, I went back to the job. I had taken leave for about a week, and then I remember that I was at Bangalore and we were in the middle of a meeting with the MSIL, which is the government wholesale in Bangalore, and I get a call from the chief secretary's office in Imachal. And this is on 18th of March. And he said, can you come down on 20th March? I said, what happened? He said, you had applied. So we want to see you immediately.
Approved.
So I was quite flabbergasted and I was not prepared. So what was coming? So I rushed to Shimla. And there was a youth committee. You had the chairman, electricity board, and chief secretary. And they said, well, you had applied for a project, so we are giving you 3 sites for allotment.
Amazing.
So I said, but, you know, I had nothing to say, actually. So I just kept quiet. I said, so when I came out, I was asking people, I said, what happened? I mean, I don't have that kind of network.
Yeah.
So he says, you see, but the people who had that much of network, nobody came to sign up for a bank guarantee of 2 lakhs. Mm. So I said, okay, I'll give you the bank guarantee in 2 days. And so we were allotted 3 sites. And my dad said, okay, I'll develop one and you develop the other. So he went ahead with his project. And this was the first project in Himachal which was commissioned. And then once I signed my PPA, I continued with the other project.
That's quite amazing. So coming, talking of energy, you know, what is happening in the energy sector in our country? You know, as we were growing up in India, we were always energy deficient.
Yes.
We never had power.
Yes.
Today, things are changing. And there's a lot of focus on renewable energy.
Yes.
So, would love to get your perspective on what is happening.
See, energy, the power sector has changed dramatically in the last 5 to 7 years. Typically, I would say, installed capacity is growing at the rate of 9% on a CAGR basis. Consumption of electricity is at 3.5% per CAGR basis. And we are the third largest consumer of electricity in the world.
Really?
Yes.
After? America and China.
After right? America, China. And even at this level, our per capita consumption of electricity is below the world average.
Okay.
So world average, you say, is around 2,600 units. And we are still at around 1,200 units. So a lot of catching up to do. But yes, now with a lot of push towards green source of energy, the entire mix of capacity is changing. The coal plants are now put on the back burner for obvious reasons. In fact, a lot of coal plants are going to be retired very soon. There is a dramatic push in renewables because wind and solar can be put up very fast, unlike hydro, which take a long, long time. And so much so that now, earlier, 75% of the power used to come from coal and gas and lignite. But now, I would say renewables is the new buzzword.
Mm.
And this, by 2030, we are committed to get at least 40% of our power from renewables. By renewables, it's solar, wind, small hydro, and large hydro. So I guess that is the way forward because we have committed to low carbon footprint in the energy sector, and so renewables are going to get a lot of push.
So I was reading somewhere they said by 2040,
yes,
India's consumption will be greater than that of America.
Yes, absolutely.
Do you think we have the capacity to?
Obviously, we have. That? We have a lot of potential. In fact, our hydro potential, we have just tapped 1/3 of it. Small hydro, we are just 20% of it. In fact, I was reading solar energy has the potential in India to provide energy combined of all the coal, hydro and all the source we have installed as on date. So the potential is huge. And of course, now the government is giving a major push to solar, but then we have to be very careful okay. because waste disposal in solar is a huge issue.
Is a big
issue. So that may not come now, but 20 years later,
yeah.
I think it will be a thing.
Well, the solar cells will have to be.
Yes.
So, you know, Neeraj, with Prime Minister's objective of 800 gigawatts
yes.
of solar power, and I believe we are ahead of his targets, what will that do to price of electricity?
Price of electricity, Ashutosh, is likely to go up.
Will go up?
Will go up. Mm-hmm. The reason being that as of now, electricity is highly subsidized.
Which still is subsidized.
It's still subsidized. In fact, solar power, the entire push is being given, is also highly subsidized. And subsidies, you know, cannot last very long.
Correct.
And in fact, the reason why most of the utilities are bleeding is because they are hardly able to recover 80% of their costs.
I see.
And generation is, Ashutosh, only 40% of the cost.
Mm.
Then you have the transmission, you have the distribution, and our distribution, a lot of investment needs to be done.
Mm.
A lot of, because you can imagine if you got to give power, like the current mandate of the government is power for all 24/7.
Mm.
And so you have to electrify each household. So the diverse nature of the consumer is posing huge distribution challenges.
Mm.
And this will all lead to ultimately increasing the price of electricity.
See, that's it. I didn't realize, I thought the subsidy was on capital equipment, but I did not realize that as a consumer, my power is being subsidized.
Yes, because you know, you are getting subsidy for solar, for example, you get subsidy on land. You get subsidy on transmission line because the government will construct a transmission line to your solar plant.
Mm.
Then you have, of course, tax holiday is there for all power units. But besides that, you have a lot of other subsidies in terms of lower taxes. GST is 5%, whereas others is 18%. So all this,
yeah.
You know,
will someday catch up.
Even the equipment financing, what you have rightly pointed out,
mm.
they charge only 2% as interest. So all this leads to low tariffs.
So then the converse of the question is that with so much happening with so many players,
yes.
do you see a consolidation?
Yes, it has to because see the entire consumption of electricity is through a common grid. So that grid connects all power plants all over the country
mm.
in which you will have solar, you will have hydro. And the disadvantage is that solar potential is available in some pockets of India. Similarly, wind potential is available in some pockets, but the consuming centers are elsewhere. So you have to construct transmission lines to wheel your power there. And then you have to have adequate, strong distribution network to provide power. In fact, the latest is that we will become power surplus by end of this year.
End of this year?
Yes, because the energy deficit, which used to be 10%, mm-hmm. and peak energy deficit was around 15%, is hardly now 0.5% to 0.7%. So very soon we will.
So we should be completely free of power shortage and light going out.
Power shortage is a different kettle of fish, because the reason for power shortage is broadly there are four or five reasons. Mm-hmm. One is you have blackouts, which we call, mm-hmm. which means if there is imbalance in demand and supply, the power stations trip as mm-hmm. a protection measure. So you have blackouts and so therefore power cuts. You have brownouts, mm-hmm. which is caused by poor quality of equipment, mm-hmm. poor maintenance, or improper load management, that you have too much of load in one center but you're not able to feed that. And economic reasons, because the distribution companies or DISCOMs, they are not able to buy power, mm-hmm. so because they don't have the money to pay for it. So all this leads to power cuts.
That's an amazing 101 on what causes power cuts. Blackouts, brownouts, and not ability to buy.
Yes.
What about theft?
Theft, of course, is another reason. But, theft is, I think, more of a mismanagement. Mm. And, in fact, the agriculture sector, you have a lot of unmetered connections. Mm. And the second stage of power reforms, which is due anytime, you want to have the advent of smart grids. Okay. Now, what smart grids are going to do is going to revolutionize, the consumption and production and distribution of power. Okay. So typically, your house will have a smart meter. That smart meter, on a real-time basis, will pass on information of how much electricity you are consuming. And so therefore, you would know where are the major consumers of electricity, where to dispatch the load, where the losses are taking place, okay. where the thefts are taking place. Yes. So all that will be plugged. Okay.
So hopefully we won't see that hook hanging on a cable outside a politician's
because farm. It can immediately come to light.
Okay, wonderful. So Neeraj, moving on to the next part of our segment. You and I have spent close to 40 years, and now we are at an age group which is around 60. A lot of Indians do not prepare for life after 60.
Right.
And this is more so with today's healthcare. Most of us will probably live till 1995, which means your life after 60 will be almost equal to your working life.
Yes.
You transitioned very early.
Right.
Into an entrepreneur, and therefore there's no superannuation for you. What would be your advice or thoughts to people who are in their late 40s, early 50s, who are not even planning on what to do after 60?
Actually, one should plan it out, as you say. But for planning, I think you have to start action very early.
Correct.
And the action has to be, you have to discover what drives you, what is your passion in life, because that can certainly take you beyond 60. And to achieve that, then you got to be very decisive and just take the step. Take the risk.
Correct. Well, a lot of people don't want to take that risk.
Well, if you don't risk the unusual, then you have to face the ordinary.
Correct. Well said. So, Neeraj, as an entrepreneur, what have been some of your key learnings as you were building? I mean, you did speak about 3 crore net worth and then 2 lakh. And I remember in those days, 2 lakhs was a lot of money.
Yes.
So, while you were building this project, what were some of your key learnings?
Ashutosh, setting up this unit was a huge challenge for me, because hydro encompasses the entire facet of engineering, be it mechanical, electrical, or civil, and it covers the entire facet of management. And here I was in a assignment where virtually everything had to be done single-handedly because I couldn't afford resources. So be it project management, management of contracts, handling labor unions, land acquisition, handling the government, statutory compliances. I mean, you name it, it was there. And therefore, every day, it was something new to be done. And at the same time, huge investments had already gone into the project. So there was a rush to complete it,
correct,
and at the fastest time possible. And one of my learnings, and I must admit here that raising capital is pretty hard.
Correct.
And this was one of my major challenges. Because while I went headlong into it, we do a kind of a detailed project report. And you know the kind of money which is going in. But I must share with you this incident where I think during 2005 or 6, the Chinese Olympics was happening in China, and steel went into a shortage.
I see.
And we had budgeted for steel at 10,800 a ton. And not only the shortage, the price shot up to 30,000. And hydro project is nothing but cement and steel. So everything went through the roof, whether it's steel, whether it's equipment, whether your turbines, generators, transformers. And there I was stuck, where I had to now raise money double of what, which I had initially planned. And I was in a hell. But then, as somebody said, if you're in a hell, just keep going. So I kind of, try to raise money wherever I could. We redesigned our plant, cut down on transmission costs. And so on 33 kV line, we went on 11 kV line. But you may do whatever. Ultimately, in this kind of a line, it's very capital intensive. And unless you put money on the table, no supplier takes you seriously. Because you're dealing with top quality suppliers like the Schneider and the ABB. And So that was a very big challenge for me. And I overcame it. Fortunately or unfortunately, it delayed the project. But that has been a huge learning.
So just a few more questions about you personally. Professional entrepreneur, first zoology, then I am Bangalore entrepreneur, in between a corporate professional. What has been the reasons for all the success?
Well, Ashutosh, I can tell you there is no secret sauce, but then yet I would say perseverance is, I think, one of the major reasons for my success. As they say, the rock can be cut not by the power of the river, but by the persistence.
Okay.
So it's a never give up attitude. And I think my family, because my wife is a co-founder with me, my brother and my children, they supported me all the way. And therefore, I had nothing to fear from failure when my family was behind me.
Correct.
So I think I would say these two were the major reasons which pushed it forward.
So one more question I ask all my guests, and I'm going to ask you the same question. What has been your biggest learning from your biggest failure?
Well, as I mentioned to you, one of the failures has been raising of capital. So my biggest learning is that whatever venture you want to plan, you have to plan double the amount of
resources,
funds for that. Because it's very uncertain, and business, as you know, it's like jazz. you do not know what's coming next.
Okay.
So I did that mistake, and in fact, very similar to that, my personal expenses and business expenses, they kind of snowballed into one big fund, which should be actually ideally separated.
Interesting. So last question for you. You know, you're now a senior entrepreneur, successful, power plant going in well, and yet there are thousands of people who watch our show. What would your advice be to entrepreneurs who are starting their journey?
My first advice is don't risk more than you can afford.
Correct.
And secondly, start early. There is no right time. You will never find the stars aligned, or you will not also find, you know, the traffic signal green at the same time. So the question is, start acting and course correct along the way. And that would be the biggest advice to them. And in fact, I was reading a small poem about, you know, I feel is very apt to young entrepreneurs.
Yeah.
And I, if you permit, I can share it,
please,
for the benefit of
you
your listeners.
You must.
It's in, it's by an Urdu poet, Faiz Ahmed Faiz. And it goes, कुछ लोग तुम्हें समझाएंगे कुछ लोग तुम्हें समझाएंगे वो खौफ तुम्हें दिखलाएंगे कुछ लोग तुम्हें समझाएंगे वो खौफ तुम्हें दिखलाएंगे जो है वो भी खो सकता है जो है वो भी खो सकता है इस राह में रीज़न है इतने रीज़न मीन्स रॉबर्स अनसर्टेनिटी इस राह में रीज़न है इतने कुछ और यहाँ हो सकता है कुछ और तो अक्सर होता है पर तुम जिस लम्हा में जिंदा हो पर तुम जिस लम्हा में जिंदा हो वो लम्हा तुमसे जिंदा है ये वक्त नहीं फिर आएगा अपनी करनी कर गुजरो जो होगा देखा जाएगा
वेरी हाउ नाइस हाउ नाइस आई डिडंट रियलाइज दिस एस्पेक्ट ऑफ यू एज समवन हु एंजॉयज एंड लाइक्स पोएट्री बट नीरज थैंक यू सो मच फॉर कमिंग ऑन आवर शो इट्स बीन एन एब्सोल्यूट ऑनर एंड प्लेजर टू स्पीक टू यू एंड टू रीकनेक्ट आफ्टर सो मेनी इयर्स थैंक यू Thank you for listening to the Brand Called You podcast. Be sure to visit tbcy.in to join the conversation, access show notes, and discover fantastic bonus content. You can follow us on YouTube, Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. Simply search for the Brand Called You. Thank you, and see you next week.